Okay, I do believe it says we are recording, so I think we're on. This is Digressionists episode 6, and we're doing something a little bit different tonight. What we've decided to do is, rather than just launch into our digressions or have a big topic, that we would both do 5 minutes of something that we wanted to talk about that's on our minds. And we wouldn't tell the other, so that we'd each take a turn and do 5 minutes, and then do another 5 minutes, and then when we get done, we'll see what we have to say about each other, or maybe we just move on to something totally different. So think of it as sort of an opening monologue, and we'll each have this. So tonight, Professor Rice will go first for his 5 minutes, and we're flexible on time, but partially we wanted to do this. I know some folks don't watch all of these things, and so we wanted to have something kind of interesting up front just to get you started, and hopefully that you'll stay with us. So with that said, I'll turn it over Marty and let you go.
Okay, well, first of all, I want to say happy Canada Day to all my friends in Canada and your friends in Canada too. Happy Canada Day to our one commentator, Patrice Scatoline. I want to say happy Canada Day to you, your family, to Lori, Mark, Sophie, Clara. Happy Canada Day to Martha Farkas in Ottawa, John Thompson in Ottawa. I hope you become subscribers to this, okay? And way over in London, Ontario, I want to say hi to Peter Jedicke, Diane Jedicke, Mark Toby. Back in Montreal, I want to say hello to Carl Jorgensen. Oh, who else? And way up in Quebec, Denny Verrier. I want to say hello to you, who always comes to the Adirondack Astronomy Retreat. And whenever we have a rain out, you host our astronomy quiz party. So thank you for that, and happy Canada Day. And again, okay, so now we're going back to Canada again to some of Patrice's comments on our last video, maybe the video before that as well, concerning free speech. And he starts his comment off by saying to us, an old saying that you probably know, freedom of the press is guaranteed only to those who own one, goes the saying. And that's true with Facebook and YouTube. So presumably you can scream all the free speech you want off your front yard without going to jail, but using someone else's press, like a university classroom or YouTube even, you need to abide by their rules. Now, let me say a few things about this. Going back to our First Amendment to the United States Constitution, and even though Patrice has provided me links to Canadian sites and the Canadian Supreme Court and their view about hate speech and free speech and things like that, I have to admit that's something I'm not familiar with. At some point in time, I will read those. So what I want to talk about is free speech and the law in the United States. Now, first of all, the First Amendment to our Constitution, which is the Free Speech Amendment, seems to make a distinction between free speech on the one hand and freedom of the press on the other. So it seems like there's a presumption that there's already something called freedom of speech running around out there in the ether, different from freedom of the press, and that Congress can't restrict that. Okay, so Congress, okay, so this is aimed at Congress, but as we all know, interpretations of the Constitution are fluid all the time. So Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, okay? So freedom of the press, free speech, two different things. And it seems like there's the presumption out there that you as human being have the right to speak freely on issues right away, okay? But now, can you do that on someone else's platform? Well, it seems like yes and no. Yes, you can, okay? So let's see. Let me go to, hang on a minute, I've got a telephone call here coming in.
I'll put you on timeout.
Put me on the timeout, okay, and I just can't answer it right now.
Okay.
Because Okay, there we go. It's going to go to message. Please go to message. Okay. Very good friend of mine calling me. Got to go okay. It went to message. Oh, and that's thrown me off kilter here. Okay. So now the other phone.
Now your cell phone. Well, yeah.
Now this is the house phone. That was the cell phone earlier.
That was the cell phone. Well, we'll extend your time for, you know.
Okay. So this is my answering machine is going to pick that up at some point. Okay. 1946, the U.S. Supreme Court made a decision in a case called Packingham versus North Carolina. It was an issue where in Alabama, there was a company town, belonged to a shipbuilding company. We used to have company towns in the United States. They have disappeared. It was a town where the property, all the property, the housing, everything was owned by the company you worked for, and you got a place to live as a result of being an employee of that company. Those things have all disappeared. We had a bunch of them here in Western Pennsylvania. They were associated with the coal mining operations. So they've all been, they're gone. They're just gone, okay? A woman walks on to this company town. This is Marsh versus, excuse me, Packingham versus North Carolina. This is Marsh versus the state of Alabama. Okay, so a woman named Grace March, members of Jehovah's Witness, for purposes of proselytizing, walked on to the grounds of this company town, passing out religious literature near the post office. Okay, local sheriff comes along, says she can't do it. She continues to do it. She's arrested. Okay, and the court, in a 5-3 decision, ruled in favor of Marsh. The opinion, joined by three justices, was authored by Justice Hugo Black. The court noted that it would be an easy case if the town were a more traditional, publicly administered municipality, then it would clearly be in Marsh's favor. Okay, then there would be a clear violation of the right to free speech. The question became, therefore, whether or not constitutional freedom of speech protections could be denied simply because a single company held title to the town. So analogous with Facebook, YouTube, Twitter owning the server, you walk onto their property. Okay, seems like it's something very analogous could be stated about the computer age. Okay, so in its conclusion, the court stated that it was essentially weighing the rights of property owners against the rights of citizens to enjoy the freedom of press and religion. The court noted that the rights of citizens under the Bill of Rights occupy a preferred position. Accordingly, the court held that the property rights of a private entity are not sufficient to justify the restriction of a community of citizens' fundamental rights and liberties. So if you lived in the company town, you had the right of free speech, okay? As well as the fact, if it's open for commerce and somebody walks onto the grounds, you have the right of free speech, okay? So analogize that with Facebook and Twitter and all the other social media that open their doors and say, hey, come in and talk and, you know, give us your views about X, Y, or Z, okay? So I think a case could be made based on Marsh versus Alabama that you've got that right of free speech on places like YouTube, that where we are. Okay. Now another case. Okay. We move to 2017. We get a little bit closer to home. It's Packingham versus North Carolina. Okay. So North Carolina had convicted over 1,000 sex offenders based on its statute barring access to all social platforms. So if you were a convicted sex offender in North Carolina, you were not allowed to use social media, social platforms, okay? So here was the decision of the court. They said a fundamental First Amendment principle is that all persons have access to places where they can speak, listen, and then, after reflection, speak and listen once more. Justice Anthony Kennedy wrote that opinion. Given the fact that social media platforms in particular allow for this kind of free communication, and that the Constitution protects the right to exchange ideas, the justices recognized this case was widely societally important. With Kennedy writing the following, let's see, do I have that here? I think this is what they wrote. Okay, I'll read it. Social media allows users to gain access to information and communicate with one another on any subject that might come to mind. With one broad stroke, North Carolina bars access to what for many are the principal sources of knowing and current events. So if you've got the right to access these social platforms, yet on the other hand, you don't have the right of free speech, it sort of makes null and void your right to access the platform to get that information if the information is not free. Okay, so the conclusion here is that the justices seem to agree that social media is a public forum. And that's the key here. It is a public forum, okay, where you've got the right to read information and express your views about the information. Okay, they do say read, speak after reflection, and then listen once more. Now that seems pretty open and shut, okay? And it made a lot of people nervous. Now we go to 2019, just last year, okay? And let me see this particular ruling, okay? This headline that I'm taking a look at seems to say that the Supreme Court signals loud and clear that social media sites are not public forums that have to allow all free speech. But now that's a little misleading, okay? So the case we're talking about, which was decided in June of 2019, is Manhattan Community Access Corporation versus Halleck. And the Manhattan Community Access Corporation is a TV channel. It's a TV channel. And they fired one of their producers over certain content that she allowed on the channel. And then she sued based on free speech. Okay. And the court ruled. And now what's interesting, this time, the decision was made by the conservative justices on the court. In a decision written by Justice Brett Kavanaugh, the conservative justices ruled that the First Amendment constraints didn't apply to the nonprofit, which they considered a private entity. Okay. Providing a forum for speech wasn't enough to become a government actor, the justices ruled. Okay. Now, this is a little different from Facebook, Twitter, social media. It's a TV station, and you just can't, you know, call them up and say, hey, I've got a program I want to put on. I got a video I want to put on, okay? But everybody went gaga over this, okay? All the social media pundits, because they think, now we're safe. We don't have to allow free speech, okay? Nowhere in this ruling, nowhere is the internet or social media discussed in the ruling, but the idea that the decision could be used to penalize social media companies was raised by groups like the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Now, interestingly, the liberal justices sided with Halleck. How about that? The liberal justices on the court in a dissenting ruling argued instead that the terms under which the nonprofit ran the channels for the city, it's a TV channel now, TV channel, not like social media where you pick up a computer and you can just blog anything out there you want. The liberal justices argued instead that the terms under which the nonprofit ran the channels for the city should have bound it to the First Amendment constraints. Okay, because now the nonprofit organization is running something on behalf of the government, which is not allowed to restrict free speech. Okay. So the issue here was not whether or not you've got, well, the issue here was mainly about who owns this public forum. Is it a true public forum? The conservative justices said, no, it's not a true public forum. Okay. Liberal justices didn't say it was a true public forum, but linked it to the city government, which is bound by the First Amendment constraint for free speech. But then, and even though the First Amendment talks about Congress shall not make the law, okay? Subsequently, we've come to consider that First Amendment constraint applying to all governmental agencies. So this is a very different. I mean, people, you can't get over this. And I'm reading these stories from Wikipedia, by the way. You can easily find them on the internet. You can't get too happy about this if you're the owner of YouTube or Twitter or something like that, because it applies to a TV channel. And whether or not it's linked to the government and doing something on behalf of the government. Not a question of whether or not it's a public forum. Well, anyway, I see that my time is up. Okay, so Chris, go ahead.
We'll have more to say in the subsequent as we get going, because that's really interesting. And I read all the things that you sent me too. So it's fascinating discussion. I'm going to talk a little bit. I'll try to keep this short, but maybe it's a little off topic and not so deeply philosophical. But one of the things I wanted to talk about. And people have asked me, you know, why are you making this, you're doing these videos, what's the purpose for it? And it's kind of interesting because people say, you know, what's your plan? What do you intend to do with this? And of course, it always goes to monetization. You know, are you hoping that you'll get enough viewers that you'll somehow be able to make money?
And, well, last month, we lost one.
Yeah, we lost one. And the other thing is, you know, people, well, your production quality, you're just doing Zoom and then you're just making, you know, YouTube video. And if you're going to really attract viewers, you need to slick it up and you need to have an introduction and you have to. And so let me just stop right there. And I'm going to call that pressure the advertising model, because it infects everything on the internet. So it does tie in a little bit to this, but it's true really, really since the days of television. And television had a huge impact, I think, on the way students were in the classroom. I mean, I imagine that people complained about the distractibility of young kids after television started to become ubiquitous. I'm sure that that's true. So, you know, I started thinking about this too, and you think about that inherent pressure that you got to make it slick and you got to monetize and you got to do all, everybody has to be in the same thing. And then you end up, your life becomes, you're sort of working, you have to work your LinkedIn and you have to work your YouTube. And you hear this from all kinds of people, is you don't exist unless you're sort of slickly packaged out there. And I guess as I thought about this more and more, like, you know, what am I trying to do? And you know, I finally said, you know what? That's fine. If we get 5 viewers or we get 5,000 viewers, it's not going to make a big difference to me. In some sense, I really think of it as, I don't know if this is the right word, but sort of commemorating a friendship and kind of reacquainting and talking about, because we have some similar ideas and we certainly spend over our time together hundreds of hours in discussion. Sometimes we agree, sometimes we don't agree. But, you know, the thing is now, I noticed Marty said, I think that the average length of viewership is something like 12 minutes, but I think on the average web page, the amount of time spent is something like a few seconds, that people look at a website in a few seconds and they're done with it. And by the way, when they read a web page, they read it in an F-shaped pattern. They don't read the way you think of reading book form. It's had huge, and I think we could talk more about this, but disastrous consequences for education. Because now, I remember once I had a student that showed up a week late and I gave her a big stack of things to read. And she said, oh, so you just want me to take this stuff home and skim through it? And I just went, no. You know, I don't want you to skim anything. I want you to read from left to right, top to bottom. I want you to read every damn thing in here and know what it's saying. And so we've now gotten to this point where we have these incredible short attention spans. Microsoft did a study and they said the average human attention span is now 8 seconds. That's pretty short. It turns out that the goldfish has a 9-second attention span. Now, I know there's some ins and outs and caveats to that, but we're shorter than a goldfish. And that can't be good. I mean, it really isn't good for our society to have to package everything into these just amazingly tight, short little things, because it affects the quality of what we do in a classroom. So you can't go 55 minutes. Your students are dying at 55 minutes in a lecture hall. Even if they really like you and like the material, you know, it's the equivalent, I think, of sitting on an airplane when you've got explosive diarrhea and thinking somehow you gotta make it for the next half hour of this flight. And you're just like, ah. And a lot of students, I think, have that feeling because they want to get to their phones, they want to get to social media, do this other stuff. And so this long form stuff is sort of just, you know, I don't know. It's a strange thing. And here we are trying to do 50, 55 minutes of something. And I hope people would watch all the way through it, but I can't get angry about that. I understand it. Even academics today are complaining that they don't read journal articles anymore. They don't read textbooks. They find their attention span has changed so much. But, you know, just think about this, and I'll end with this one thought, and you think about this. It's that you keep hearing this week or the last 2 weeks, we've heard this before over and over again, that it's time that we had a serious conversation about race in this country. Well, that's fine, but there's apparently two things. You know, number one, make sure you don't offend anybody, and make sure you get it done in 8 minutes or less. And I just have to tell you, I don't think that's very good for this country, that that's all the further we can get. So that's kind of my rant. So for me, I look at these things as sort of commemorating a friendship, and whether or not they'll stand the test of time or somebody will look at them that might remember. So I have no clue, but it's just fun to do them. And that's really what we're up to here, I think. So I'll end there and we'll open the floor for comments and digressions.
Yeah. And digressions. Okay. Yeah. and I'm sure now, and also let me mention that my friend Patrice in Montreal assures me, and I believe him about this, that he watches our videos to the bitter end.
Well, good. I mean, I think there are always people that are like that. And they're pretty rare to do that. I mean, but, you know, hopefully, but they have a personal relationship with you. And I don't know who's going to come across us. I guess that'd be interesting. Oh, one other thing for Patrice, too, that I saw the other night that I thought was very interesting was that during World War II, Roosevelt determined that baseball is an essential service or an essential thing, and so kept it going during the wartime because it was so important to morale and you know, tradition and everything else. So again, it points to the fact that it's not some kind of simplistic thing that you can just quickly figure out.
Interesting. And yeah, of course, that seems right.
It's kind of like the remark we had in one of our, I think maybe our first video about the importance of music.
Yeah.
I don't know that musicians going to a studio or certain radio station, you know, in some sense you might say, well, hell, that's not essential. But you think about it a little bit, it kind of is essential in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. What you see today is when I'm in the gym, when I'm out running, oh, my gym is back open again. I don't know if I'll go there yet. Okay, I'm going to wait a bit. But you see people wearing their headphones, okay? Mm-hmm. And what are they doing? I've been out on bike paths where people are listening on their headphones. Sometimes they're listening to a podcast.
They're listening to our podcast right here.
Yeah, right.
It'd be nice if they did, but...
We wish.
We wish.
Get lost on subscriber in the last month. We're down from 102 to 101.
So, hopefully we'll pick up some more. But I think what you said earlier is spot on, that I don't think yet we've gotten to the point that we've got the clarity on this. And some of it, we talked about this a little bit, just a bit, but it's also a question about competition and whether or not there are alternatives to these platforms. And not, I think when you look at the power and the impact, I mean, a lot of people will tell you today, you know, you're nobody if you, excuse me, if you don't, you know, if you're not on Facebook or LinkedIn, you're not on these services, you're pretty much invisible in American society.
Exactly. So it seems an artist friend of mine who lives in Ligonier, I'll give him a plug here, Stephen Patricia, who does archaeological restorations, historical paintings, things of that nature, who is in our age bracket, maybe a little bit younger. He's been told the same thing. Hey, you're not with it, man. You got it. So now he's got to have a website. So he's got a website, and he puts himself out there on the internet, competing with the younger folk. And he finally realized years ago that, hey, he's got to do that if he wants to compete, if he wants jobs.
It's sort of a different point that moves away more from your thing to my topic. But, you know, you have people who are artists or musicians, and they say, well, you know, this is this whole thing about gatekeepers. In the old days, if you were a good musician, you'd find a gatekeeper or an agent, and they would do a lot of work for you. Today, those people are gone. Those middlemen are gone. So you are your own PR person. So what happens to a lot of musicians is, there's no time to make music anymore.
Yeah, your agent. Your agent got you the gig.
Got you the gig. Now you have to do it. So you spend all of your time on these social media platforms. You don't make music. And there are people that lament that, you know, I'm not painting because I'm spending all my time trying to build more hits on my webpage. And by the way, this is one thing that I talk to my students a lot about, this is people have no clue. You know, for us to monetize this, if we had 5,000 people watching this, we still wouldn't make any money. If you got to maybe 500,000, you might make money. But what you don't realize is that to make a normal sort of middle class living as a social media star, and a lot of young students are interested in that, it's phenomenal how many you have to have, how many hits.
And YouTube keeps raising the bar on that.
Sure, raise the bar, so it gets higher and higher. If you look at those numbers, by the way, same thing with app development. And I know, you know, where I teach, they have a workshop where they teach people to do app developments. It's something like 80% of all apps ever made make, guess how much money?
Zero.
And that to make a middle-class living off an app, you better be in probably the 1% of the 1%.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are some companies where people make millions, but really, it's so much more like the lottery. It would like be telling a room full of students, you know, you should play the lottery as your career. Because after all, somebody is a millionaire every week. Could be you. It only takes one. So build these apps. It only takes one great app and you could be a but it's just the worst kind of advice you could ever give somebody. And I know that shocks a lot of my students, but I tell them, don't ever think about it. Find something else where you can plug along slowly and develop skills. But it's just so hard.
It is. We have recently instituted at Pitt Johnstown a major that's called, in abbreviation, MMDC, which is Multimedia Digital Culture. And I now you would think that, you know, well, part of that is we can transfer things like writing for a newspaper to writing for an online news organization. Okay, well, maybe you can, but then you need a real journalism program for that. Mm-hmm. That's really what you need. Our journalism program has just collapsed because our one journalism professor, a really good old school guy, Lee Wood, just retired. So that's gonna go. So I know that our MMDC people are going to put themselves out there as having as part of the MMDC program, Training in Journalism. But the people we got running the MMDC program are all people like creative writing people. So we've got these creative writing people running this program, these writing people without training in journalism, okay, which Lee gave them very good training in journalism. And, you know, I'm just wondering what's going to happen with all this. And of course, it's, should I say it, it's more or less a soft major, you know, and so it's drawing a lot of people.
I'm wondering, and I guess I'll throw this out, but do they get told what the real facts are about trying to make a living in some of these things? I
don't know. I have to say,
my guess is probably not, but because I would tell anybody, any young person that came to me and said, I want to be a YouTube star, or I want to be an app developer, I'd say, look, I would show them the stats, but I'd say, you're better off taking your money and playing the lottery.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Probably so.
And the whole thing about like a video going viral, somebody tells you, look, pay me $100 a month and I'll teach you how to make your videos go viral. Well, you and I know there's no such thing as that. There's no such body of knowledge that would tell you how to make a video go viral, because we can't all go viral.
Mm-hmm.
The whole concept loses its meaning. It's sort of a content universalization thing.
Yeah. You're overwhelmed with viral videos, you know, and your brain is fried.
But it's just.
But we got to be careful here in talking about economic impact, because you and I are both philosophers, and we've made a living as teaching philosophy. And what does everybody say about, you know, philosophy?
Okay. We have to do a video on that too, and talk about exactly that philosophers actually do very well career-wise, even if they're not in the teaching business, that they outperform almost so many other majors. We should do something on that some night. It turns out to be really good advice to a young person, study philosophy.
In fact, it turns out that people majoring in the liberal arts over their entire lifetime and career time actually, over the years, end up being, well, if you want to talk about money, on the average, making more money than somebody in maybe engineering.
Or certainly journalism.
So if you want to, and if you're an engineer and you want to really start making the big bucks, guess what you got to do? You got to get out of engineering, go into management, something of that nature. You're now in management, something like that. And I'll tell you, I talk to people who are in that end of engineering, and it drives them nuts. Just because of the workload that they get in that. And now they're no longer doing hands-on engineering stuff, the stuff they love to begin with, that put them into that particular field. Okay. You got to look at different ways that this goes, and not just that, well, when I get out with my degree, I'm going to make $100,000 a year. Okay. Well, I don't know how you're going to do that unless you're a very, very good hedge fund manager or something like that.
Yeah, there are very few things like that. Yeah, it turns out, and it's interesting too, when you talk about all this high tech and social media, that so many of the really big wheels in this industry have their undergraduate or even graduate degrees in philosophy. Peter Thiel, that was, the PayPal creator, now is off into all kinds of AI and mysterious stuff. Philosophy major, on and on and on. It's astounding how many of the top Silicon Valley guys have their degrees in philosophy. And once you start looking at them,
the chancellor of the University of Pittsburgh did his undergraduate degree in philosophy, and he told me once he did that for fun, and then he did his PhD in physics. And under Obama, He became director, I guess it's called director, of the Department of Weights and Measures. Mm-hmm. And Obama's director of the Department of Weights and Measures. And then when the university advertised for a new chancellor, he applied for the job. He got the job. He's now chancellor of the University of Pittsburgh, running a university and not doing physics.
Now, they're not trying to make us go back to the metric system, are they? Speaking of Canada today, right? To our Canadian friends, you have to understand that Americans cannot understand the metric system.
No, we can't. We have nothing to relate it to. Now, let's talk about that. Nothing to relate it to. What do you mean by an inch? Well, in Spanish, an inch is un pulgada, the thumb, right there. The English system is relatable to body parts. In a way, the metric system is not relatable to body parts, okay, and easily understandable. You know, you can grasp quite easily what a foot is, what an inch is, but, you know, you start talking about a millimeter and a centimeter.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then you got to start talking about, well, at human lengths, we got to start talking about 22 centimeters or something like that, okay? And then the whole concept of the temperature.
Yeah, yeah.
Fahrenheit is a much better measurement of how you feel.
Because it has much longer gradations.
Much longer scale, yeah. Right?
Celsius, okay.
A small change in temperature in Fahrenheit is a small effect on you. Small change in temperature in centigrade is, my golly, what's happening? I'm freezing to death or I'm burning up or something like that.
Yeah. Okay.
It's a much, much better measure of how you feel. In the Fahrenheit.
Now we're going to tell you're going to have people all completely confused about what the hell. And I think about the Canadians too, because you have Americans that go up there for the first time and the sign on the highway says 90 and they're just going 90 miles an hour.
They don't realize 90 kilometers.
90 kilometers, yeah.
Or you think gasoline.
If you do go there, you've got both of them on your speedometer, you know, in America. So.
Well, you go into the gas station, you think gasoline is dirt cheap.
Yeah, like $1.49.
Basically a quart of gasoline.
Exactly. And you got to have about four of those to make it. So next thing you go, oh my God, you're killing me.
Exactly.
I know, it is fun. And it is interesting that our Canadian friends are perfectly fine with, you know, our system and their system. They could care less. They go back and forth, you know, so. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Not Americans.
No, we're not. We're not fine with that foreign stuff. Because by the way, it comes from France too, doesn't it?
Okay. Yeah. And isn't it interesting that that still got what I think the space shuttle or something they screwed, or the, was it the Hubble? They screwed something up. They did it. They did it in, you know, US and instead of metric, and they got something screwed up.
To fix it.
Yeah.
Is what
spent
they
them the no, wrong was, wrenches.
The mirror was not tested on the ground.
Yeah.
Wasn't that it? The mirror was not tested.
The one I'm thinking of is something that they had done that they were out of phase because they did something metric and it should have been, or they were U.S. and the parts came in. I think they were U.S. and it should have been metric, and it caused some kind of something related to that. I'd have to dig it up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm not sure. But yeah, the mirror thing, that's.
The mirror thing too, whatever. And now, having worked in chemistry in a former lifetime before I went into philosophy, it does make doing your calculations easier, okay? But then in my head, I was always thinking to myself, okay, what's the equivalent in, you know, the English system that makes
If you think about it, the secret to getting over to the metric system is you just dump the other system and you don't do that calculation anymore. You just quit doing that. I mean, if somebody just said you have liters, then you quit for, you know, you just you have to kind of go all the way at once. And then over time, you know, nobody cares about the translation,
mm-hmm.
I guess. But Americans will never do that.
It's natural to them.
Yeah. Okay. It's like daylight savings time. That's another thing.
I wish we had daylight savings time all year round.
don't get going on that, you know. And then Indiana has part of it that's daylight.
Oh, I know. I know. You go through those little counties in the boot there of Indiana, and you really don't know what the hell time is.
Yeah, it's going back and forth, and then
go back and forth, and until you come out in Missouri or something like that. Then the time is right, and
you have to. You finally back on track. Wasn't it in Indiana somewhere where they used the legislature to fix the value of pi at 3.14?
Louisiana. I don't know. And, you know, I don't know whether or not that's true. You know,
I heard it was Indiana, but, you know, it's still a good story.
Well, talk about legislatures fixing values. Okay. In honor of the discoverer of the planet Pluto, by the way, Clyde Tombaugh. Clyde Tombaugh taught at the University of New Mexico his entire life, okay? He was an engineer and did a lot of stuff with rockets, missiles, optics, things of that nature. The legislature voted that Pluto is indeed a full-bodied planet, okay?
Social construction of reality here, or?
It's a legislative construction of reality. Okay. Which, and legislatures are not afraid to do things like that.
Like that, yeah.
Okay, not afraid to do that. You know, if I pick up, say, when I used to be able to buy methylate, okay, the disinfectant, mm-hmm. okay. Back in the early 90s, I noticed they had a label on the bottles that said, according to, in the state of California, this is known to cause X, Y, and Z.
Cancer, yeah, usually.
So epistemology is relative to what you know is relative to which state in the U.S. you happen to be in. So there are certain things.
It's kind of interesting if something says it's known to the state of California to cause cancer. It should be true that it's known for all 50 states, right, to cause cancer.
It could be. You would think so.
Yeah, if it's truly known.
If it is.
Yeah.
If you want to go with that old justified true belief definition of knowledge, I'm not so sure I like that. Okay, that's something else we could talk about as well.
Well, we get back to S knows that P, but who the hell is S? So
exactly, who is S?
Who's the mysterious S in this? Yeah.
And a lot of people in epistemology, well, there is that path you go from Gettier, okay, down through Keith Lehrer and George Pappas, Marshall Swain, and other people, okay, and wonder. And then there are the people who, you know, aren't really happy with that, okay? Mm-hmm. People like Michael Polanyi, mm-hmm. who is not really happy with that. I'm not happy with the idea that you also have to add into the definition that the thing you know is true, because that seems to beg a question here. If I also have to know it's true, well, know it true, okay? There's something funny going on there, okay? I also have to have a grasp on the thing's truth. How do I do that? That's a problem that goes back to Plato's Meno, where Socrates, near the end of the Meno, raises the question of, well, here are the elements of knowledge, like the letters in a syllable, okay? And do we also have to know the elements, okay? And then do we have to know the elements of the elements, and so on and so on and so on, okay? And so you have to know your steps of justification as well as the thing you want to justify, and you're in this infinite regress. But anyway, I'm going to go back to advertising.
Do you remember that? Just throw this as a digression, but when we were graduate students, do you remember there was a conference on all that S knows that P, and it was days and days and hours of people reading their papers of, you know, examples and counterexamples, and it was, you know, 23 prime, 23 double prime, and a counterexample to that, and these things, it was maddening for sure.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And they're taking these notes. Well, wait a minute. There's a counterexample to that. So we have formulation 49. Mm-hmm. And they get to something in the end that would be this huge convoluted thing, and then somebody else would get
it. Oh, it does. If you read the stuff that Keith Lair published, mm-hmm. okay, you really go nuts.
Yeah, it's mad.
The counterexamples get so complex,
mm-hmm.
the definition gets so complex, that really you can't hang on to all of it.
Yeah,
exactly. Like that.
What am I doing? Yeah.
And I think a good thing to read on all that is Alvin Plantinga's Knowledge and Proper Warrant, where he goes after all these people and all the problems with those particular definitions. And then we had the era where you wanted to counterexample some of the things Keith Lehrer said about you're justified in believing that P when you have a direct visual experience of P. Mm-hmm. And then people talked about barn facades.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, yeah, I mean, the counterexamples get, well, I got wrapped into that. I wrote some paper that had some wild scenario that kind of goes against Gettier or whatever, but you know, but those were the times, and that was legitimate stuff to do that kind of thing.
Exactly. I still think Plantinga's two volumes of Warrant and Proper Belief, I think that's what they're called, those two volumes are the best stuff written on that. Also, if you want to investigate religious epistemology, mm-hmm. you know, how do you know the truth of religious beliefs? Roy Clouser's Knowing with the Heart, I think, is very, very good there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and he attacks this idea that as part of the definition of knowledge, you have to have the thing you know is also true, okay?
Yeah.
Which seems to require you to have another round of justification,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. inside your justification, which is very funny. So we're left with the possibility that you could know something and it turns out to be false. And if you're not left with that possibility, then you're left with Descartes' possibility that everything you know is a necessary truth. And that's certainly counterintuitive.
Yeah, certainly. Yeah.
Okay. That certainly is it a necessary truth that I have to be wearing a blue shirt today? Okay, instead of my usual black t-shirt? No. It's not. Happens to be true, but it's certainly
I don't know. Maybe it is. I have to, knowing you, I don't know.
If you know something about my psyche.
You know that that's a necessary.
That has to be right. <Let's go. coughs>
So did you have another comment about advertising that you wanted to make?
Oh, yeah. I got lots of comments about advertising I want to make. And I don't know if we've mentioned this before in these videos, but your usual college bookstore, which is also your local Walmart, Kmart from when you're on campus, stocks all kinds of sweatshirts, expensive mm-hmm. sweatshirts with the college logo or symbol embroidered on it, sometimes very heavily embroidered. And last time I checked, these things cost upwards of $50. Okay, and students are buying them and wearing them around campus and other places. And I'll say to them, you know, you should be paid by the university for wearing that because it's free advertising for the university.
Oh, yeah. Exactly.
Paying the university instead. Okay. I have a University of Pittsburgh sweatshirt. I didn't buy it. Okay. My sister came across it somewhere in New Jersey. And when I was out there visiting one time, she said, yeah, here's your present. Okay. So I got a University of Pittsburgh sweatshirt that I didn't buy. Okay.
Yeah, you know, you wonder with this monetization business and advertising, you know, how long will it be until you as a college lecturer will come in and you'll have your, you know, ExxonMobil, you'll look like a NASCAR guy. You'll have ads all over your shirt, you know, to come in, monetize your classroom, you know, make a little extra money. Nobody's ever proposed that, but hey, reach out to us. I would wear something if you want, you know.
Mm-hmm. I'd want to know what's in it for me.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, you want to put a logo and I'm standing up there and you know, hey.
Because you know, in recent years, you know, I've tried to dress somewhat better. One of my favorite channels is Gentleman's Gazette on mm-hmm. YouTube. Okay. Run by his first name is Raphael and I forget his last name. So anyway, a great channel for how to dress and how to dress, sometimes how to dress nicely, but cheaply as well. Except for when he sells socks for $70 a pair. No, I'm sorry, Raphael. Then I go to Walmart.
That's a little bit much for that. Yeah. Oh, that's another topic we should do sometime. It goes back to the free speech thing. I mean, when you read Hentoff's book, which I just finished, you come away with the impression that colleges are just filled with rude, nasty people that have nothing better to do than to yell slurs to all kinds of homophobic, racist slurs. It sounds like you got this really troubled group of people. But, you know, maybe that's true, maybe it's not true, but let's suppose it is true. Isn't part of instead of having all of these draconian speech laws, why don't we talk about manners and etiquette? Mm-hmm. I don't know anybody that does that.
No. And several years ago, a colleague of mine pointed out to me, there was a website where you saw pictures of people dressed differently, mm-hmm. and you were asked, can you guess if this is a hobo or a college professor? You know, college professors dress like hobos, okay? And I've seen that at our place, sometimes with the adjuncts. But at our place, people mostly dress very conservatively. One time, a couple of years ago, it was in the spring, near the end of classes, I'm walking from the parking lot into Biddle Hall. I run into a friend of mine from engineering. He's wearing shorts. Okay, and I said, Brian, what are you doing? You're in shorts. He says, well, we're going to do some welding today, and I don't want to ruin good pants, you know, if something drops on them, something hot, and burns a hole in them or something. Okay, well, more power to you then. Yeah, I know, like when I worked in the chem lab, okay, do I want to wear a tie in the chem lab? Well, no, damn it. You don't want to wear a tie in a chem lab because of, you know, you lean over, and the tie gets into something.
And it's ruined. But you know, it's interesting. When you start talking about clothing, and it has a huge impact on the workplace and whether or not people are accepted in workplaces. And yet, people think it's just a horrible thing to talk to students about their clothing. Mm-hmm. But it gets to be a really interesting point because you talk about. This is something that used to be true, is that there were occasions in which we dressed up, and it was a way of showing that we took it seriously and we respected it. And now that's only a handful of things, like funerals. And even there, people are in blue jeans today, or in church, they're in blue jeans and whatnot. And so you look at college students and I look at them and I say, when you look at the standards of changing in the clothes, you realize it telegraphs the message. This doesn't really matter much to you because you look like you just rolled out of bed. You got slippers on. You're in sweatpants every single day when you come to this class. Where's that sense of showing that this matters and that this is important?
Exactly.
I don't see it.
And as for wearing blue jeans in church, yeah, I'm guilty of that myself.
You're bad. We're going to have a talk about that.
You will.
And you used to be an admirer of, you know, Italian design and good sport coats and shoes.
Yeah, one of my favorite movies was American Gigolo, okay, for how he dressed in that particular movie.
But it is true. I mean, you come in, I've had plenty of classes where I've walked in and whoever's teaching is just getting ready to leave, and you just go like, and I got to talk to my students about etiquette matters, and I look at this guy and I think, oh my God, mm-hmm. you know, really, you teach for a living, and this is, and it tells me you don't really care about these kids because you're showing up in the worst outfit. It's like somebody dragged you off working on your car now to give a lecture on something. Really, exactly. That's all that it matters.
I will say this though, for our people who teach rhetoric and communication, okay, when students have to give certain speeches or presentations in class, they are required to dress up for that. And in the engineering division as well, if they're giving a certain presentation, they have to dress the part.
That will probably be on its way out.
Yeah, maybe.
I'll make that as a prediction, because a lot of people are, and it's funny, you get people really hostile. Don't tell me, they'll tell you that what I wear has says nothing and communicates nothing.
Which is not true.
That just isn't true.
Right.
I mean, it's very interesting to listen to the justifications that students have for, and really what it comes down to is it's all about me and my comfort. Yeah. And comfort is not the only thing that matters in this world.
Exactly. I wore shorts to teach class once when I was teaching in Houston, Texas.
Well, that's because it was 115 degrees.
100 degrees with 99% humidity. And you walk across campus, and by the time you get from your car or whatever to the air conditioned classroom, you look like you've been swimming. They're just, everything is just absolutely drenched. So one day in symbolic logic, I thought, I'm going to wear shorts. I'm sorry, folks. This was just too much. It was in May. It was 100 degrees. And in Houston, after February, March, that temperature starts rocketing upwards. Okay. And I did that once. I've never done it here. And I won't do it here. Although I have worn blue jeans to class. I have done that.
Go ahead.
Let me tell you when I do that. If we have 3 feet of snow. I got to dig out my driveway at 6 o'clock in the morning to get the class, and I'm in boots and I'm in jeans, and I see that, my God, I've got maybe just an hour and a half to get to class, and I know the roads are bad, so I got to leave right then, and I don't have time to get a shower afterwards. Maybe I don't have time to shave, so I just throw on my University of Pittsburgh hood. I'm in blue jeans. I'm in snow boots. I head off to class, hoping I can get there, living just, 15 miles from campus, but leaving myself an hour and a half to get there because the roads are just so bad and people doing crazy things on the road to get to work. And
there's a real, if somebody wants to follow up on this and about clothing and everything, there's a great book by a philosopher named Karen Storr, S-T-O-H-R, who is out at Georgetown. And she's written a book called On Manners, and she tries to provide a groundwork for manners that's based on Kant's humanity formulation of the categorical imperative. So that ultimately, matters of etiquette turn out to be moral matters, and that they should be taken quite seriously.
Yeah. Being polite to someone. How much concern do you have for a friend of yours if you show up at his wedding in shorts and a t-shirt with the
sleeve. I'm treating you as a means, or I'm not respecting your unique humanity or dignity in that sense, or the dignity of the event.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just there, and so you're, I don't know. Yeah, it's a very interesting book, very easy to read. So if you're sort of not, you like philosophy and you like ethics, and so you pick up her book called On Manners. It's a short book. Pretty easy to go through, but she tries to make the point that they are moral matters and you need to take them seriously. So clothing and politeness does matter, because.
And this is Karen Storr.
Yeah, Storr, S-T-O-H-R.
It might be something to use in an ethics seminar.
It would be. It's very interesting that people will go, because most philosophers think of ethics or etiquette as some sort of irrelevant icing on the cake or something, really. And her thing is, no, it's much, much more bedrock and much more deeply ingrained in an ethical way of life, and that you have to, you can't ignore it in that sense.
Yeah. You make me think that maybe I should wear a button-down shirt like you do, and maybe a tie the next time we do this.
Well, isn't it true that part of professional life, and if you're like I do, teach at a community college, you're trying to teach people how to go out into the world and to find jobs and to make and to have better lives, And it's an important topic. And guess how many people in the entire system talk about that throughout any of their education, through their basic university courses when they join? Zero discussion about that. I'll have to say more on that next week then.
The head of our humanities division has a little checklist that he gives to the adjuncts to fill out about what's expected of them. And one is dressing properly in the classroom. And because my last name is the same as one of our adjuncts, I used to get these emails all the time wondering, what the heck am I doing with this? Okay. And so I went to his secretary and said, why am I getting this? You know, am I a slob in the classroom? And then I have to sign it? No, I'm not going to do that. Well, it was a mistake. But he makes the adjunct, at least the last time I talked with an adjunct about this, he makes the adjunct sign this and turn it in. So he's got evidence that they...
Yeah, I mean, and today, unfortunately, what happens is you're likely to end up being sued that it's highly discriminatory and unfair to tell somebody what kinds of things they should wear. I mean, it's amazing the hostility out there about this topic.
Yes.
If we want to get lots of hits, you know, just listen to Mr. Wilson's lecture about that and it'll get everybody torqued off.
Okay.
Up your game a little bit. You don't have to come up in a, you know, suit and tie in a three-piece suit, but for God's sakes, if you're teaching, don't show up and, you know, with
flip-flops
in your pants and flip-flops.
No flip-flops.
Yeah.
No flip-flops.
You know what? If you're on an airplane today, guess what you see? Flip-flops are everywhere. It's disgusting. Think about, I give my students, we should do this. I show them pictures of flying in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. And then I show them pictures of what airplanes look like today. And most of my students are stunned.
Yeah.
And here we are, progressing into a new world, and it's 2020, and it's a modern world, and really everything looks so crappy. Why does everything have to look like some bus station?
Exactly. Flying was important.
Yes.
You wanted to look your best when you
considered it somewhat of an honor. It was an important thing, and so you honored that by dressing appropriately and dressing up, and it shows that it's something that you take seriously, any more than if some famous politician was coming to dinner, you'd probably dress up.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Maybe a lot of students would say, no, I'd be in my PJs, to hell with you. If you can't take me the way I am. That's the argument, the counter argument that you get.
Yeah. Well, it is linked to showing respect to the other person. In fact, a friend of mine who has seen maybe one of the videos that I did for virtual teaching during the pandemic lockdown has said to me, you should be in a shirt, tie, jacket. And he did, you know, he did compliment me. He says, you look nice in those. And that's normally how I teach in the real classroom, you know, but I was thinking here in the bunker. And
I think you need a fedora and then a pipe. And a big whiteboard behind you, you know, so you can...
Something like that. Well, yeah. Chris, how long have we been going here?
Yeah, the clock is here, and we are just at 1 hour, maybe an hour and 1 minute or so.
And we're taking people over who need to go to another class.
Yeah, get going. And by the way, when you get to that class, look at how they're dressed and ask yourself whether or not that instructor really cares about you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, more on that.
More on that later.
Hopefully people enjoyed today and the format. If you like the format, tell us so, and we'll continue it. If you'd like to see something different or you'd like us to consider a topic, shoot it over, let us know.
Subscribe down there.
Subscribe. And yes, it can be philosophical, sociological, psychological, whatever. We're happy to
hear from philosophers. If you hate it, let us know.
Yeah.
If you hate it, let us know. Yeah. We'll engage you in discussion, just like we engage with Patrice, because he's our lone commentator.
I know. We still keep going on about essential services, and that's fine. We'll go until we, you know.
Oh, someone else who watches us to the end, my friend Gretchen. she watches us to the end.
Well, that's good. I'm surprised that people do, but that's because people have a personal relationship to, you know, to you or to me. Maybe somebody watches it, but you know, the average person. But again, we don't have to belong to the advertising model. We can do whatever the hell we want. YouTube isn't charging us, so we can go on as long.
Yeah, or until YouTube bans us.
Yeah, they'll probably hear something that's offensive. I'm in here suggesting people wear better clothing, and then they'll tell us, well, you got to go.
I hope not.
I hope not, too. I hope we can keep doing
okay,
it.
Okay, Chris.
Fun. All right, I'm going to go ahead and stop the recording. Thanks for everybody for joining in. It was fun today. I had a lot of good topics, and we'll try to get something going for next week.
Comment, please.
Okay. Happy Canada Day to everybody. Bye-bye.